For many young Germans in the period before the Nazis took power in Germany in 1933, their first acquaintance with flying came through gliding. One such was Adolf Galland. His first encounter with gliders and flying came in 1927, when a group of enthusiasts brought their aircraft to the hills near his home. He described watching them as a revelation. Although seen by many just as a sport, gliding was also the only way the armed forces could foster air-mindedness in a new German generation forbidden access to powered flight. It was the extensive use of gliders by the Germans that had prompted some radical thinking on their possible employment in military operations. In the mid-1930s, research was undertaken to explore the idea of troop-carrying gliders, thereby creating the first element, which along with paratroops and transport aircraft, would lead to the emergence of the world's first genuine airborne forces. It was the Soviet Union that pioneered the use of paratroops in the early 30s. Employing modified bombers, paratroops crawled out onto the wing and then dropped off. While crude in method, the potential of this new way of delivering troops to the battlefield was taken up by the new German Wehrmacht. The third element in the emergent Luftwaffe airborne operations team came with the introduction of one of the most remarkable and long-lived of all the aircraft types to emerge from the stable of Hugo Junkers. The trimotor Ju-52, which is forever associated in the popular mind with the Luftwaffe's transport wings, was itself derived from an earlier single-engined variant which first flew in October 1930. Distinguishable from its single-engine stablemate by the addition of the 3M suffix to its designation, the trimotor Ju-52 very quickly ousted the earlier type on the production lines. Its obvious attraction as a commercial transport saw it enter service within 2 years with a number of airlines. It is seen here in the livery of Deutsche Lufthansa, the German state airline with which it became one of its most important types, operating over all of the major routes in its European network. With the accession of the Nazi Party to power in January 1933 and the decision to secretly embark on building a new German air force, the Junkers company found themselves rapidly expanding production of a modified Ju-52 to accommodate its use by the new service as an interim bomber. By the end of 1936, the Ju-52 equipped two-thirds of the Luftwaffe's new bomber wings, a number far greater than originally envisaged due to the failure of the purpose-designed Do-11 and 23 bombers. The Ju-52 first saw action in Spain, but the availability of the new second-generation bombers saw it transferred in ever-growing numbers to equip the squadrons of the Transportverband. Ju-52s first saw operational employment in the transport role in 1938 during the occupation of Austria, when a paratroop battalion was landed at Graz-Thalerhof. Those seen in this sequence are in the process of landing infantry during the German takeover of the Sudetenland in the second half of 1938. They were to repeat this role when Hitler ordered German forces in to occupy the rump of the Czech state in early 1939. By the time of the great military parade to celebrate Hitler's birthday in 1939, Göring had succeeded in bringing under Luftwaffe control all experimental paratroop formations set up by the German forces. It was thereafter as Luftwaffe units that the Fallschirmjäger went to war in 1939 and fought through to 1945. The measure of the effectiveness of the Ju-52 in its various roles was that by the time of the German invasion of Poland, on the 1st of September 1939, no fewer than 1,600 had been built for military and commercial use at home and abroad. In order to accommodate the demand for the aircraft, production had been spread across a number of manufacturers in addition to the parent company of Junkers. During this period, further development of the aircraft had seen the emergence of more versatile subtypes, employing more powerful engines and incorporating greater fuel capacity for longer range. The possibility of fitting skis and the addition of floats also increased the Ju-52's effectiveness. features that would be put to good use by the Luftwaffe in theatres such as Russia and the Mediterranean in years to come. Throughout 1939, production of the type for the Luftwaffe alone was running at about 11 per week, and at the time of the invasion of Poland, there were 552 Ju-52s on strength with the Transportverband. Although a paratroop drop had been planned but subsequently cancelled during the campaign in Poland, the nine Ju-52 equipped Transport Gruppen were employed supporting other Luftwaffe and Army units during the eastward advance, with personnel, fuel and spares being flown to forward operating bases. Combat losses of the type amounted to just 12, with a total of 44 Ju-52s being written off to all causes. The launch of Operation Weserübung on the 7th of April 1940 saw a large number of Ju-52 formations involved in the occupation of Denmark and Norway. Flying from the airbase at Uetersen in Schleswig-Holstein, German infantry were flown into Aalborg in Denmark on the 9th. Other Ju-52s flew a much longer route to drop paratroops to secure the airfield at Stavanger Sola in Norway on the same day. With the base captured after heavy fighting and made secure by anti-aircraft defences, numerous Ju-52 sorties were flown from Denmark to airlift infantry into Norway to help support the paratroops in the fighting. Many other aircraft types were also used as transports in this operation. With the launch of the German invasion of the West in the early hours of May the 10th, 1940, a vital role had been allocated to the Transportverband and the Fallschirmjäger. For the first time in history, an attempt was to be made to eliminate an enemy in rapid time by envelopment from the air. Many of the 430 Ju-52s available for service were allocated to the airborne assault on Holland. Over 2,000 paratroops were to be dropped to capture strategically important bridges and airfields. Once the latter were secured, the paras were then to join up with the troops of the 22nd Air Landing Brigade, who would be airlifted into captured Dutch air bases near the capital, and together they were tasked with the rapid seizure of The Hague in advance of the Army's ground forces. The novelty of this approach lay in speed and surprise. Nevertheless, while the assaults on the airfields at Waalhaven and Valkenburg were successful, they were not secured without losses. Even as the fighting for control of the airfield at Waalhaven was continuing, the first Ju-52s containing the air landing troops set down. These disgorged their troops while still under fire, and a number were hit. At Valkenburg, the air reinforcement by the Ju-52s was also made more difficult by the very soft and muddy surface, in consequence of which it took longer for the Ju's to leave, and the airfield thus became highly congested. The Dutch counterattacked and drove the Germans back, forcing a number to surrender in the process. The attempt to seize The Hague by a coup de main had to be cancelled. The paradrops to secure the bridges at Rotterdam, Moerdijk and Dordrecht were also successful, with General Student's men suffering 180 casualties in the process. With so few men available, Student had employed a sleight of hand to suggest that he was stronger by dropping a large number of dummies with his genuine paras. Over the next few days until the Dutch surrender, the paratroops joined with other German forces who had reached Rotterdam in the fighting for the city. By that date, the 9th Panzer Division had arrived and the German forces swept systematically through the city to the docks. In a foretaste of what would be experienced at Crete the following year, Ju-52s setting down at the airfield of Ypenburg were fired on by Dutch artillery and destroyed. A large number of Ju-52s were lost in this manner. In all, some 160 Ju-52s were written off, with only 53 being repairable, a figure corresponding to a 40% attrition rate. The 10th of May also saw the Germans employ the first glider-borne assault in history. The type of glider employed was the DFS 230. This had been developed in the mid-1930s by the German Gliding Research Institute and ordered into limited production for the Luftwaffe in 1937. Compared to latter types, it was small, able to accommodate a crew of 2 and 8 fully armed troops. Although it employed a wheeled dolly for takeoff, the glider landed on a skid and was towed either by a Ju-52 or Heinkel 111. It was the DFS 230 that was employed in one of the most audacious efforts of the war up to that time. Crucial to German plans for a rapid advance into Belgium was the capture of the bridges and forts at Eben-Emael. Believed impregnable by their builders, the guns mounted in the forts had a range of up to 20 miles and were so placed to block any German advance. It was Hitler who had observed to Generalstudent that the grass growing on top of the fort looked like a meadow and was thus suitable for landing gliders. So it was in the early hours of the 10th of May, 42 DFS 230s were dragged aloft by Ju-52s. All the gliders, bar one, tasked with landing on top of the fort, did so safely, and the 78 men of the group then proceeded to move against the forts, using hollow charge explosives on the gun turrets. Although the Eben-Emael did not surrender to the following day, it had been put out of action with speed and at the cost of 6 paras killed and 15 wounded. After the action, both Hitler and Generalstudent met and congratulated the Fallschirmjäger who'd participated in the operation. A number were awarded the newly introduced Knight's Cross. The obvious success of German paratroop operations in Holland and Belgium was not lost on the British or Americans, and both powers began to quickly develop their own paratroop units. One of the many variants of the Junkers trimotor was the Ju-52/3MS, where the suffix letter S stands for the word Sanitätsflugzeug. This was the special ambulance version and was easily recognisable by its white colour scheme and highly contrasting red crosses worn on the fuselage and above and below the wings. In the early years of the war, the perception of the passive nature of these machines was further enhanced by allowing the Ju-52s employed in a casualty evacuation role to carry civilian registrations. In the CASEVAC role, the interior was configured to carry up to 8 stretchers. The scenes inside the Ju-52s in this film illustrate the still relatively low casualties experienced by the Wehrmacht up to this time. In Russia, the need to get large numbers of wounded out of encircled positions often saw stretchers packed into bursting point. It was to fulfill a requirement issued by the Luftwaffe in October 1940 for a large transport glider to be employed in a further campaign against Britain that Willy Messerschmitt designed the ME-321 Gigant. The prototype Gigant emerged just 14 weeks after Messerschmitt had been given the go-ahead and very much lived up to its name, being the second largest aircraft ever built up to that time. What was even more remarkable was that a further 11 examples of the Gigant were already in final assembly and another 62 in the pre-assembly stage. Employing a structure of welded tubing covered with fabric and using extensive amounts of wood, the airframe was designed to lift men and equipment to approximately twice its own weight. In all, a maximum of 200 troops with supporting weaponry, such as the 37mm anti-tank gun, could be carried aloft. The fuselage was stressed for the carriage of armour. Although it could carry one Panzer IV medium tank, two of the lighter Panzer 38Ts could also be airlifted, as is seen here. Both are reversed into the Gigant with some care. The presumption was that such armour would be needed straight away in the event of a future invasion of England to support air-landed troops in the battle for the bridgehead. Such was the all-up weight of a fully loaded ME-321 that it was recognised that it could not be towed into the air without the assistance provided by detachable and reusable rocket pods. These came in the form of 4 Valter hydrogen peroxide-powered rocket engines each delivering 1,102 pounds of thrust, permitting a 30-second burn at takeoff. First flight of the Gigant took place on February the 25th, 1941, with a Junkers Ju-90 providing the motive power to set the huge glider airborne. However, it became very obvious that even with the assistance of the rocket pods, which were ignited only as both aircraft began to accelerate, that the Ju-90 had barely enough power to pull the 321 up off the runway and into the air. Trundling along on its two-wheel jettisonable carriage, the 321 can be seen bouncing up and down on the runway as the Ju-90 struggles fitfully to gain height and pull its huge charge aloft. Once airborne and free of its tow plane, the pilot flying the Gigant was able to report that, although the controls were very heavy to operate, the glider nevertheless handled well. After making a circuit of the airfield, the 321 came sweeping in low over the boundary to make a landing on its under-fuselage skids, which was indeed how it would be employed if ever used in combat. On this occasion, the underwing rocket pods have not been jettisoned and remain in place under the wings. As it runs along the grass strip, it passes both the Ju-90, which has already landed, and other Gigants being readied for their first flights. Future trials by the Gigants were not so uneventful, with a number of crashes occurring, including one in which most of the troops on board were killed. Although the Ju-90 was one of the most powerful aircraft available at the time, it was clear that even it was not suitable for towing the Gigant. As with the Ju-52, the Ju-90 had been designed as a commercial airliner for service with Lufthansa, although when war came, the very few of the type yet delivered were taken over by the Luftwaffe and pressed into service as a military transport. Never destined to be developed to tow the huge glider, the Ju-90 evolved into the larger and more powerful 290 and 390 series. A temporary and very hazardous solution pending the availability of a purpose-designed Gigant tug was the use of three Messerschmitt Me-110 heavy fighters to form what became known as the Troika Schlepp. Three of these fighters, each joined to the Me-321 by a cable, would take off together to tow the glider into the air. It was Ernst Udet who proffered the original idea of mating two Heinkel 111 bombers to form an aircraft that would be able to lift the Me-321. What at first appeared to be a crazy suggestion was, on closer inspection, seen to have much merit, especially as it would enable an aircraft already in production to be quickly modified to become a powerful glider tug. Two 111H6 fuselages were joined by employing a stub wing mounting a fifth engine. The newly designated HE-111 Zwilling first flew in late 1941 and entered service in the early summer of 1942. It was on the Eastern Front that the Zwilling saw most service, towing the 321 into and out of airfields in southern Russia, where one of the latter is seen parked along with an Me-110. The Gigant also saw much service in 1941, being used in support operations in the Baltic states, in the follow-up to the advance on Leningrad. The decision to build a powered 321 had been taken very early on in the aircraft's development. Initially, four engines were employed, but the need for more power led to six French Gnome-Rome radials being adopted as the standard fit. The newly designated Me-323 also acquired an undercarriage. Production began in 1942, with deliveries beginning in September, with the first operations being flown into Tunisia to supply the Axis bridgehead. The German invasion of the Balkans and Greece would witness the most significant airborne operation yet launched at this time. Even though the invasion of Russia was scheduled for launch in the summer, with all that entailed in terms of the allocation of the Luftwaffe's resources, the campaign in southern Europe was to see a major commitment of the assets of the transport Verband. Indeed, when launched on April 6, 1941, all Ju-52 equipped transport units found themselves committed to the offensive, including the three new transport Gruppen raised at the beginning of the year. No fewer than 270 of the tri-motors and a large number of DFS 230 gliders were provided for the operation. As German armour thrust into Yugoslavia and Greece, the airborne element of the offensive plan swung into action. Flying out of the Bulgarian airbase at Plovdiv in the very early hours of the 26th of April, the fleet of Ju-52s and their gliders landed at the recently secured staging field of Larissa in Greece to refuel before flying onto their target. The objective of the paratroops was to seize and hold the Corinth Canal, thereby blocking off the retreat of Commonwealth forces across this waterway and southward into the Peloponnese. Shortly after 0700, the Ju-52s released their charges and the DF's gliders swooped into the target to deposit the men of Fallschirmjäger II near to the bridge that crossed the canal. This was secured, albeit with losses, and the retreating British forces surrendered thereafter. It was the Fallschirmjäger commander, General Kurt Student, who argued the case that only the capture of the island of Crete would put the seal on the German conquest of the Balkans. Although the German high command was pushing hard for employment of the paratroop arm in the seizure of Malta, Student drew Hitler and Göring's attention to the strategic value of the southern Greek island in its relation to the vital British position in the eastern Mediterranean. The subsequent decision of both men to endorse Student's request was to see the Luftwaffe commit its paratroops to its greatest and most costly operation of the war. Even as the planning went on among the troops earmarked for the assault, other aircraft such as Hindenburg, a former Lufthansa Junkers Ju-38 airliner, now wearing Luftwaffe colours, flew supplies and especially mountain troops earmarked for the attack into Athens. In the interval prior to the beginning of the assault, the paras prepared their equipment and loaded up their weapons containers. These were then attached to the underside of the Ju-52 and would be released separately over the drop zone by the pilot. The paras were thus separated from their rifles and machine pistols as they landed, a factor that would work against them when the assault began. The Ju-52s seen here being loaded by the troops had already been returned post-haste to Germany for rapid and extensive overhaul. While heavier loads could be carried internally by the Ju-52, outsize equipment such as the Zundapp motorcycle combination, used as a transport by the paras, and the 37mm anti-tank gun employed as light artillery, together with the 20mm flat guns, were accommodated on special racks mounted between the main undercarriage members under the fuselage. These were jettisoned either on landing or were airdropped using parachutes at low level. Approximately 80 DFS 230 gliders were assembled for Operation Mercure, the codename allocated for the assault on Crete. On this occasion, their participation was to verge on the disastrous, with many of the troops killed while still inside their gliders. Although the film taken by the newsreel cameraman suggests a dramatic opening to the events of the 20th of May, the date for the assault on Crete, in actuality many of the paratroopers and pilots seen making last-minute preparations by attending final briefings had found themselves working through the night to help fuel the Ju-52s that would airlift them to the island. As the plan called for at least three sorties to be flown by each aircraft, no less than 3 million litres had to be transported to the various airfields on which the 493 Ju-52s available for the operation were dispersed. Once there, it was the paras who found themselves drafted in to join the ground crews in fueling the Ju's from drums using hand pumps. Nevertheless, by dawn and the beginning of the loading of the transports, all aircraft had been fueled and made ready for the start of the operation. In total, the Germans had assembled nearly 23,000 men for the attack, organized in Fliegerkorps numbers 8 and 11. Of these, 10,000 would be paradropped, 750 landed in gliders, 5,000 air-landed by Ju-52s, with the remaining 7,000 troops being dispatched by boat. Start right. Offensive air support for the whole operation was to be provided by a large covering force of bombers, Stukas and fighters. The German plan called for the assault to be launched in two waves, with the initial targets being enemy airfields. Group West would be paradropped and glided in to capture and hold Marlim airfield, while Group Centre would secure Kania. The destruction of enemy anti-aircraft defences and elimination of all opposition on and in the vicinity of the airfields were given as priority objectives to the attacking paras. While losses were to be expected, German hopes for success were nevertheless high, given their own purported superiority in numbers against a mixed British ANZAC force on the island, estimated by military intelligence to be as low as 5,000 men. The subsequent heavy German losses came about as, in actuality, there were no fewer than 37,000 Allied troops on Crete.
Unter uns Kreta.
To the defending troops, the appearance of the German air fleet over Crete was likened to a long black line as of a flock of migrating birds occupying the sky from as far east to as far west as could be seen from horizon to horizon. In spite of the extensive softening up by the Luftwaffe, once the paras began jumping and their speckled green and white chutes filled the air, the Allied ground troops opened up. One defender likened it to shooting ducks from the air. Junkers 52s attempting to land and offload troops at Heraklion were hit by artillery fire and destroyed. The gliders fared equally badly. Many were riddled as they swept into land or crashed amid rocks. Few of their troops survived to fight in the subsequent bitter battle. Although paradrops continued throughout the 20th of May, by the end of the day, German losses amounted to some 40% of the total force landed in dead, wounded or captured. The airfields had not been secured. Nevertheless, the Allied commander, General Freyberg, was not optimistic that the Germans could be denied. Indeed, overnight, a German paratroop force succeeded in capturing a vital hill around Marlim, which led to them securing the airfield. For Student in Athens contemplating defeat, this was a godsend. Orders were reissued, with Marlim airfield now to become the focus of German landing efforts and the conduit for forces sent to the island. The three sorties flown by most Ju-52 crews on the first and subsequent days of the offensive involved a long round trip. These aircraft belonging to Battle Wing No. 105, seen flying over Athens, operated out of Tanagra, a primitive sandy airstrip to the northwest of the city and located over 400 kilometers from the island. As this film was taken for propaganda purposes, no real attempt was made to convey the very high losses experienced in the air and on the ground by the German forces involved. What was seen here was at best a token. This Ju-52 is seen making a controlled crash landing, having had part of its undercarriage shot away. Other shots show the effect of enemy anti-aircraft fire on the corrugated skin of the Ju-52s, but it's clearly inferred that these are slight and easily repairable. Repair teams go to work, and in a short time the leg and wheel on the Ju-52 are replaced. On the 21st, Student ordered that troops from General Ringel's 5th Mountain Division be airlifted into Crete. These soldiers, wearing their characteristic ski caps and decked out with Kapok life jackets, are seen boarding the Ju-52s, all of which wear the yellow theater markings on their engine cowls and rudders. With fighting still going on around Marlim airfield, the Gebirgsjäger were soon winging their way to Crete. In the meantime, other Ju-52s operating out of other bases to the north of Athens and in the Peloponnese continued to ferry in further reinforcements, dropping more paratroops and also supplies to beleaguered units fighting on the ground. Many German paras suffered injury in landing on the hard and rocky soil of Crete, and the nature of the parachutes also caused problems for them in the high wind. Fierce fighting between the combatants continued over the next few days, with the Germans struggling desperately to increase their toehold on the various parts of the island they now controlled. What was beyond doubt to Student was that the small 600-meter-length airfield at Marlim had become the key to an eventual German victory on the island. Littered across the airstrips on the island were wrecked Polish-supplied fighters of the Greek Air Force and the skeletons of burnt-out British trainers and Blenheim bombers. The arrival of the first Ju-52 with mountain troops aboard at Marlim took place with British artillery fire still falling on the runway. It is, however, left to stills to capture the scale of the chaos that now took over the airfield. Very few of the Ju-52s that landed survived in one piece. Collisions were frequent. Other Ju-52s came down on the beach or ditched in the shallow water along the coast. When the British artillery fire stopped, captured tanks were hastily used to bulldoze crashed aircraft off the field to give space for the next flight to land. Nevertheless, fate had now swung in the Germans' favour, and by May the 31st, the British rearguard covering the seaborne evacuation surrendered. Operation Mercure was the most costly German airborne operation of the war. The transport Verband suffered unprecedented attrition to its invaluable Ju-52 fleet on the eve of Germany's greatest military venture. Out of the 493 Ju-52s available on the 20th of May, no fewer than 271 were lost by the end of the month, a figure amounting to some 50% of all the transports committed to the operation. So heavy were the Fallschirmjäger losses, some 3,450 paratroops killed and 3,500 wounded, that Hitler never again contemplated their mass employment in the airborne role, declaring that such operations were already passé. Although the Fallschirmjäger arm was actually to see a significant expansion after Crete, the paratroops served thereafter only as ground troops, fighting as elite infantry alongside the army in Italy, France and Russia through to war's end. When Adolf Hitler launched the Wehrmacht against the Soviet Union just 3 weeks after the fall of Crete, he was convinced that it would take merely a few months to bring down what he called this colossus of clay. Indeed, the remarkable performance of the German armed forces in the opening weeks of the campaign, in encircling huge numbers of enemy troops and all but eliminating the Red Air Force as a viable opponent in the skies above the battlefield, seemed to confirm his most optimistic expectations. The Soviets, however, showed a bitter resilience and an unwillingness to lay down their arms, as had Germany's other enemies in the previous 2 years. As the Germans plunged ever further eastward into the Russian hinterland, with their frontage growing daily ever wider, and with roads turning into quagmires at the first hint of rain, the cry always went out to the transport Verband to fly in fuel, spares and other vital supplies to the frontline units. But the chickens were already coming home to roost. The drubbing on Crete had seen the transport Verband severely weakened, and with the demand for their services in North Africa also increasing, it had been able to deploy only a limited number of formations to serve in the east. Furthermore, the vast distances these had to fly on a daily basis reduced their operational ability at the very time when demand for their services was rising steeply. This growing strain was compounded by the demands placed on the transport formations by the effect of the terrible Russian winter. Many German units, isolated and cut off by the Soviets, could only be resupplied by air. The greatest example of this was the airlift that resupplied the 2nd Army Corps cut off in the Demyansk pocket throughout the winter of 41-42. So severe was the shortage of aircraft in the east that HE-111s and obsolete types such as the Ju-86 were drafted in to serve as transports. Between February the 21st, 1942, and May the 18th, no fewer than 11 transport Gruppen were committed to this operation, flying a total of 14,445 sorties and losing at least 265 aircraft, the bulk of which were Ju-52s. The success of the transport Verband on this occasion was to have a baleful legacy, in that Goering would appeal to this example to justify his claim that 6th Army could be supplied in the same way at Stalingrad during the following winter. With the resumption of the offensive by the Germans in southern Russia after June 1942, JU-52 units were once more heavily involved, supporting the advancing mobile formations as they thrust towards Stalingrad and the Caucasus. Entering service in 1942 to augment the airlift capacity of the Transport Verband was the Gotha 242 glider. The shoulder-mounted wing and twin boom design allowed an unobstructive access to the fuselage pod, which could be used to carry sizable loads, including up to 21 fully equipped troops. Although the towing aircraft in this footage is a JU-52, the Heinkel HE-111 was more commonly seen being employed in this role. First seeing service as a resupply glider in Russia in early 1942, its effectiveness was reflected in its manufacturing total for that year of 682. A number of variants were planned, and the GO-242 remained in production through to 1944, by which time a total of just over 1,500 had been produced. Seeing service in the Mediterranean theatre, its primary employment, however, was on the Eastern Front, where the heavily landed example seen here has been used to resupply a frontline fighter unit operating in southern Russia. As with the ME-321, the prospect of fitting engines to the 242 was explored at an early stage. The attraction lay in giving the aircraft the ability to recover itself in the absence of a suitable glider tug. Fitted with the French Gnome Rome engines and equipped with a wheeled undercarriage, the resultant aircraft, designated the GO-244, first flew in late 1941, with the first production models employing 133 modified GO-242 glider airframes in 1942. However, the 244 proved decidedly less successful than the glider that sired it, proving very underpowered. In consequence, the 244 had a very limited service career, both entering and leaving service in 1942. The encirclement of the German 6th Army at Stalingrad in late November 1942, and Goering's offer to Hitler to let the Transport Verband resupply it from the air, led to a catastrophe from which it never recovered. Although every aircraft able to act as a transport was dispatched eastward, the prospect of maintaining the daily supply levels by air was simply beyond the capacity of the Luftwaffe. Over the 2 months between the start of the airlift on November the 24th and January the 31st, 1943, the Luftwaffe lost 266 JU-52s. Even as every airfield in Germany was being scoured for any type of aircraft that could be employed in the airlift into Stalingrad, the transport arm found itself under yet more strain as Hitler ordered a massive reinforcement of Axis forces in Tunisia following the Anglo-American landings in North Africa in November 1942. Describing Tunisia as a strategic position of the first order, military resources denied by the German leader to Rommel just 6 months before were now sent post-haste to bolster the Axis bridgehead there. Although much of the heavy equipment, such as armor and artillery, was sent by ship on the perilous sea journey from Italy to Africa, the Transport Verband found itself operating numerous sorties out of airfields in Sicily. This new airlift also saw the debut of the Messerschmitt ME-323 in Luftwaffe service. Battlegeschwader 323 began flights to Tunis and Bizerta on October 1942, flying out of the Sicilian air bases at Trapani and Castelvetrano. This was not too great a problem initially, as Allied fighter interceptions of the German transports operating over water were not frequent in this early part of the campaign. Operating along with the far more numerous JU-52s, both types were often provided with fighter cover. Nevertheless, Allied aircraft downed their first three Gigants on November the 10th. With a maximum load capacity of up to 25,000 pounds, depending on the range of the sortie being flown, the ME-323 offered a unique lifting ability and was put to good use ferrying flak and anti-tank guns, ammunition, fuel and small armoured vehicles. Return journeys to Sicily were made carrying wounded. The value to the Luftwaffe, and indeed the army, of the 323 can be gauged by the loads being delivered by this flight of Gigants, seen being landed at Tunis. The capacious interior and clamshell nose permitted both easy loading and unloading of the type. Once the ground crew have placed the ramps against the nose, unloading reveals a small ammunition trailer, followed by a 3-ton Hanomag SDKFZ-251 armored personnel carrier. And finally, a 20mm flat gun.
Eine schwere Zugmaschine mit angehängtem Geschütz.
By March 1943, attrition of the type had risen steeply as long-range Allied fighters regularly intercepted the transport stream from Sicily, as on April the 22nd when the RAF shot down 14 out of a total force of 16. Not surprisingly, it was the RTU that provided the backbone of the transport effort to North Africa and Tunisia throughout this period. The decision by the Luftwaffe Command to pull a number of Ju-52 formations out of this theatre to service the airlift into Stalingrad saw even the float plane variant of the Ju-52 pulled in to support the Tunisian effort. Indeed, by mid-December, just 200 Ju-52s were left to carry the full weight of the airlift. Operating in numbers for protection alongside the ME-323, formations of German transports were so large that, at any one time, they would occupy airspace covering about half the distance between Cape Bon and Tunis. As Allied air power increased in effectiveness, the Ju-52s paid the price, culminating in a massacre of the 18th of April, when 52 out of a formation of 100 were downed over the sea near Cape Bon off Sicily. When the German forces in North Africa finally surrendered in May, the airfields around Tunisia were littered with the debris of huge numbers of destroyed Ju-52s and the skeletal remains of large numbers of ME-323s. Coming just a few months after Stalingrad, these twin catastrophes were to cripple the transport Verband for the remainder of the war. The Luftwaffe operated a large number of Italian transports in German colours, especially after Italy's surrender in 1943. The trimotor SM-75 seen here sired the larger and more effective SM-82 Kangaroo, which was used extensively by the Luftwaffe. Although underpowered, it had a greater capacity than the Ju-52 and is seen being used to carry Fallschirmjäger in the following colour footage taken in northern Italy. Although the Fallschirmjäger were not to be employed in airborne operations on a major scale after Crete, the paratroop arm nevertheless underwent a significant expansion. Paradrops, however, were still an integral part of the training of all Fallschirmjäger, as seen in this unique film taken in the early summer of 1943.
Oh. bedenkenlos den Sprung in die Tiefe. Nach der Landung blitzschnell an die Waffen.
Barely 2 months after the Axis surrender in Tunisia and at the height of the German offensive against the Kursk salient in Russia, Anglo-American forces landed in Sicily. Codenamed Operation Husky, this was the largest amphibious assault yet launched. 7 divisions from the British 8th Army and the US 7th Army, totaling in all some 181,000 men, 600 tanks, and 14,000 vehicles were landed to the south of the island by 2,500 ships and landing craft. Operating in conjunction was a large paratroop force whose experience was far from happy. The amphibious forces faced a virtually unopposed landing, and Italian formations on the island offered little resistance. Although the German forces were of the opinion this was but a feint, their few units on the island, including the Luftwaffe's Hermann Göring Panzer Division, put up a steady fight. Seen preparing Gotha 242 gliders are Luftwaffe personnel rushing to make ready the dispatch to Sicily of the 2nd Fallschirmjäger Division, which had been formed in France in the spring. Under the command of General Ramke, this formation was shifted by air in Ju-52s, Heinkel 111s and in-towed gliders down through Italy and to the south of the country. Once there, preparations were made to land the division in Sicily. The 2nd Division was landed on the island in gliders and by paradrops. This sequence provides us with the opportunity to see the DFS 230 and Gotha 242 in action. Towed into the air on this occasion by obsolete Dornier 17s, the gliders are then hauled to their dropping zone. A ready landing strip is provided by a sandy beach, and as the first DFS 230 drops into land, the cameraman switches to cover the approach of a Gotha 242. Deploying its flaps and landing skid, the pilot brings his machine in for a textbook landing, the soft sand of the beach providing an ideal braking surface. Of note is the machine gun mounted above the cockpit for defense. The crew disembark quickly as shortly thereafter another 242 glides into land. The benefit of the twin boom layout is clear as the rear of the fuselage is raised to permit the onboard load to be extracted, which in this case comprises of a Kettenkrad, a track motorcycle weighing of about 1 ton. Developed originally for the Fallschirmjäger, it was also adopted by the Army and Luftwaffe. The bulk of the division was, however, dropped by parachute. In the first wave, Fallschirmjäger are seen exiting from Ju-52s, while the second wave of paratroopers jumped from Heinkel 111 bombers adapted to serve as transports, an ever common expedient as losses of Ju-52s continued to mount while the demand for transports continued to rise on all fronts. Although the arrival of the Fallschirmjäger on Sicily bolstered the German forces there, they were not enough to stop the advance of the Anglo-Americans. The 2nd Division was subsequently involved in a hard fighting retreat to Messina, where the bulk of the formation was evacuated across the straits to southern Italy. Fallschirmjäger regiments 3 and 4 of this division were then engaged at Salerno. The high point of the defence offered by the Fallschirmjäger in the Italian campaign was at Monte Cassino in 1944. A battle forever linked with the fighting abilities of these tenacious troops. It was in 1940 that the Luftwaffe turned to the task of designing a replacement for the venerable Ju-52. Arado's design featured a pod and boom fuselage, a hydraulically operated rear-loading door, and 11 pairs of small wheels mounted under the fuselage. This gave rise to the nickname of Millipede for the 232. Problems with the availability of the appropriate engine saw, in the end, only a very limited number of 2 and 4 engine variants completed before the war's end. Evolving from a design for Lufthansa which called for a replacement for the Ju-52 to be equipped with retractable undercarriage and a hydraulically operated rear-loading ramp, the Ju-252 did not at first attract Luftwaffe attention. The worsening war situation and high Ju-52 attrition saw the latter express new interest, with the V-4 seen here being completed to military specification. Although an effective aircraft, it was, however, only produced in small numbers. A Luftwaffe request to see if the 252 could be produced using non-strategic materials led to the mainly wooden Ju-352. Production began in the summer of 1944, only to be ended shortly thereafter. Of the total number of 198 ME-323s built for the Luftwaffe before production of the type was ended in April 1944, most served on the Eastern Front and were operated by Transportgeschwader 5. In Russia, where the air environment was more benign than that of the Mediterranean, ME-323 formations were used extensively to move men and equipment around in theatre and between the front and Germany. The primary model of the 323 was the D variant, which gave way in 1943 on the production lines to the E model. Given the nickname of the Elastoplast bomber by German soldiers because of the supposed vulnerability due to its fabric covering, the 323 was not as easy a target as the name might imply. Both in the Med and in Russia, the type was found to be able to take heavy punishment and give a good account of itself with its onboard armament, which could amount to some 10 MG-15 and MG-34 machine guns. Of note on the ME-323 seen taking off in this film are the two overwing gun turrets, each mounting a single 20mm MG-152 cannon. The particular sortie being flown by this aircraft sees it take off from the important town of Zaporozhye on the river Dnieper. The strain on the Transportverband was excessive as demands for air supply continued to grow at a time when air transport assets were on the decline in the light of the terrible losses of the previous years. Nonetheless, the pilots of the transport arm, while portrayed in a less glamorous light than their fighter or bomber comrades, played a crucial role in the success of German arms in the opening years of the war, and did much to service the armed forces in desperate conditions in the years down to Germany's defeat in May 1945.